corporate job to pursue his real passion for wines. Now he's a renowned wine expert with his own brand that sells around the world.
Mm-hmm. And joining us with tips on what to look for when choosing a good wine is the founder of, I want to get this right, say it for me.
Mouton Noir.
Mouton Noir is Andre Mack. Andre Mack, thank you for joining
us.
We appreciate it.
Thanks.
Andre, welcome. Oh, there's good wine here.
Okay, so let's talk about your current profession. You are sommelier.
Mm-hmm. So I was a former sommelier, and now I kind of moved on with my education about wine, and now I make wine.
Okay, so how did you move from being a financial analyst to being one of the leading wine purveyors in the country?
That was probably the 40 pounds that I gained at my cubicle.
Okay.
It just wasn't, I didn't have a lot of action in the end of being a financial analyst, and so for me, it was I was drawn back into restaurants, just the kind of the fast-paced nature. I was missing some of that, so I went back to restaurants and then fell in love with wine.
You said you went back to restaurants, so were you in the restaurants before you went to the financial world?
Yeah, just as college, getting through college,
got
that kind
you,
of thing.
Like
everybody worked as a waiter just to kind of make ends meet.
So you started working in restaurants again in 2001, and you ended up working with Thomas Keller. I mean,
correct.
Come on, it doesn't get any bigger in the world of the culinary world than Thomas Keller.
Yeah,
French Laundry per se. How did you make that leap?
I was testing my knowledge about wine. I joined a competition. I ended up winning this competition, and along the way, I met all these really great people, and they were like, hey, come work for me. And so I was like,
but
I can do that.
You usually don't hear African-Americans going into that field. What did it take for you to get there, and how rare is that?
I think it's pretty rare. Just a sommelier in general is like starting to build a claim, but as an African-American, my mother was like, so what do you do, baby? So what you do? You get paid to do what? So you get paid to drink.
Get paid to taste wine.
Yeah, and it was just, countless hours of studying and tasting and kind of honing my craft, and then, a little bit of being at the right place at the right time.
And now you started your own company after leaving a very lucrative job at a very fancy place.
Correct.
How did you go about starting your own company, and how was it perceived?
It was through the good graces of all the people that I had met along the way.
You worked at Per Se, so
right.
You're going to meet some great people.
Yeah.
And the food there is not cheap, so I know the wine there is not cheap either.
No, nothing about it is cheap.
Exactly. But,
it was really interesting. I just met people along the way, and they were very helpful in helping me get started. And that was just kind of it. It was just kind of grown organically with a lot of hustle and, blood, sweat, and tears, so to speak.
So you live in Brooklyn, but your winery is in Oregon.
Correct. That's
how does that work?
Well, we use what's called a custom crush facility in Oregon.
Okay.
I spent about anywhere from 3 to 4 months in Oregon, based in Oregon. And that gives me the time to kind of do the things that I need to be get done. A lot of my time is actually spent on the road, about 180 days on the road.
Out of the year?
Out of the year. Basically,
you have a wife and kids?
I do.
How does that work?
Yeah, how do you balance
what do you
all
say?
That?
Daddy's got to go play with grapes now.
Yeah.
He'll be back in
well,
4 months?
They come with, right?
Okay.
So they come with. The greatest thing about all this is that my family gets to travel with me.
Okay.
Right? So I get to bring them along for some of the bigger trips. A lot of the smaller trips, I'm on the road, doing tastings, doing wine dinners, and those types of things. And my rules with my wife is 7 days on, right?
So do you remember your first glass of wine?
Yes, I do.
Okay, take us back to that moment.
It was something very simple. It wasn't, it was the chance of, I tasted two Sauvignon Blanc side by side.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that was just, it was a mind-blowing difference that these were actually the same grape that were actually grown in different regions. Mm-hmm. And from there, that's kind of where the love affair kind of started.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. And not only that, you're great at being an artist, a self-taught artist at that. And you did your own labels? You've created these labels?
Yeah, no, totally.
Wow.
It's pretty expensive, graphic design. And when I first started, I didn't have any money or resources were really tight.
Mm-hmm.
And so I decided that I would give it a shot and design it myself. It looks like my kids did it, so it was pretty easy.
And now t-shirts as well?
Yeah, we do t-shirts. We just kind of like to, to do take things light and have fun with it.
Okay, so cool. Walk us through what you brought for us today.
Great, so we have three wines. We have our Love Drunk Rosé.
Love Drunk Rosé. That
right.
Sounds fun.
So that was an ode to my restaurant career.
Okay.
And then we have our Knock on Wood Chardonnay.
Knock on wood.
Yeah, so that's all stainless steel, so no oak.
Okay.
And then we have Other People's Pinot, which is our Pinot Noir from the Willamette Valley.
Oh, that's what OPP stands
for. Yep. The last P is not that simple.
I love a good Naughty by Nature reference. You're my type of guy.
So when choosing a wine, what should we look for? Because you got so many choices here. Give us some tips.
I guess the biggest thing that you should choose is choose what you like. And if you don't know what you like, you know, go to a shop, find a good shop to buy at. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the key, is having a conversation with the salesperson or the sommelier, so mm-hmm. to speak, and talk about the things that you like. You know, are you going to drink white or are you going to drink red? Mm-hmm. For me, you know, we tried to make food-friendly style wines, and when we talk about food-friendly style wines, we're talking about wines that are medium-bodied, good acidity. When you say acidity, most people kind of freak out, but acidity is something that you need. Acidity is an amplifier. It works in the same way. The reason why you put salt on food, you put lemon on food, it cranks up the flavor dials, right?
Okay.
So you definitely want something that has acidity. And then for me, particularly, you need lower alcohol wines tend to fare well with and be more versatile with food.
Oh, okay.
Now, some people, you know, the old rule is red wines go with heartier dishes like beef and steak and all of that, and then white wines tend to go with the light fare, summer, fish, salads. Does that still hold? Is that true?
To some degree. You know, mm-hmm. rules are always meant to be broken, mm-hmm. you know, so the whole idea of rules are just guidelines, like you can or cannot mm-hmm. follow by those. But the whole idea is if, you know, to experience and drink what you like and eat what you like.
Okay.
Together.
So let's get tasting.
Great.
Yeah, enough talking. Oh, yeah.
All right, great. No, so the first one is our rosé.
Okay.
Now, how should you taste? Because I know you got to smell
first. So for me, put your nose in. You want to smell a little bit.
Oh, this smells amazing.
But when you smell, make sure you crack your mouth, right? You want to crack your mouth and kind of breathe in through your nose and exhale through your mouth. You want to open up your olfactory senses, right? 80% of taste is actually smell.
Okay. Well, you don't drink, so.
But it smells good.
So it smells good, right? Yeah.
It's Drew. Yeah. Let's bring Drew over here.
Drew, come on. You can taste this one. take my spot. Tell us what you think.
Yeah. Now, all Drew, right. This is called Love Drunk.
Love Drunk. So all the wines that I make are from the Willamette Valley in Oregon.
He's trying to get drunk right now. Drew's like, mm-hmm. Love Drunk. How does it taste, Drew?
This is it's kind of like a bittersweet. That's cool. It's not too bitter, not too sweet.
Mm. Yeah, so the whole idea is here you drink raspberry, kiwi, and watermelon rind.
Okay. Oh, right. Okay.
Good acidity, so it's crisp.
Okay, and we're going to have Ron to come over and taste the knock on wood is next, right?
Rhonda doesn't drink. She doesn't drink either.
Oh, that's all right. Better. Come on, watch.
You can come smell it. Come on, smell it. Come.
This wine is called Get Your Panties Off.
Come on. Knock on wood.
That is terrible.
Can I use that?
While we're tasting, tell people where we can buy your wines at. Where can we get your wines?
So you can go to Sherry Lehman and buy some of our wines. You can definitely buy online from us at moutonnoirwines.com. It's pretty much at all the top restaurants in New York City and across the country.
Okay, so let's try the next.
So the next wine is called Knock on Wood. What's interesting about this, when you talk about Chardonnay,
it's a Chardonnay. Right.
Chardonnay with no oak, right? So all stainless steel, so all from a cooler climate. Oh, we're jumping around here.
It smells like fruit.
It smells really good.
Okay, so wait, which one is Knock on Wood?
The white one, right? Yeah, okay. There we go.
There we go.
We got it.
So much alcohol.
That love drunk is already working.
I like, now which one is it?
This one tastes more like Put It Back.
Tell us about the 2020 rule.
It's all good. So 20, I think temperature plays a key role when you're serving wine. Okay. A lot of times people serve white wines a little too cold. Mm. So my rule is always bring, you know, your white wines, remove them from the refrigerator 20 minutes before you want to enjoy them. And your red wines, you should actually put them in the refrigerator 20 minutes before you would like to enjoy them.
Oh, okay.
So the white red wines should actually be served as slightly chilled.
Okay.
Not chilled, but you know, at around 65 degrees.
Okay. Now, other people's like Pinot. I
other
love that
Pinot.
Title. Okay.
I'm gonna taste that one.
This is OPP wine.
Appreciate it.
So other people's Pinot. This is Pinot Noir. This is something that we do very well in the Willamette Valley.
What do you think of this one? Drew didn't like this one.
So Pinot Noir here, you think of this earthy, high-toned red cherry fruit. It's a little bit of minerality.
Oh, I know why you don't like it. It's not as sweet as the
other. I like the sweeter one.
Okay, that makes sense.
I like the sweeter one.
And that's the whole idea.
Okay.
We all have our own personal mm-hmm. preference. Mm-hmm. It's like an art. And so there's no right or wrong answer.
Exactly.
You like what you like.
You just like that one because it's called Love Drunk. That's
wrong.
I'm trying to get Love Drunk over here. That's what we're talking about. That's all we need to drink is
a So real quick, what's
get
next
a girl
up for
drunk
you?
Get some love. That's what I'm talking about.
You go over there and get drunk. Take your bottle. A mess.
Rhonda, Drew wants you to join him.
Exactly.
Real quick, because we have to go. Tell us what's next for you and your company. What can we expect?
I'm on the road, so we'll be coming to a town near everyone else.
So I think your wines are already working.
Yeah, they're look at them. Look at them. It's great.
Love Drunk.
Love Drunk. It is.
All right.
So we'll just follow you on your website and keep looking out for all the stuff.
Great. Yeah, we'll be on the road coming to a town near you.
And really quickly, your website one more time.
It's moutonnoirwines.com.
Okay, perfect. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Great, great.
Thank you for bringing the wine.
Here you go, Drew. You're watching Arise Entertainment 360. Here you go, more for you.
What's that? The name.